Welcome to the online worship experience of College Park Presbyterian Church. My name is Maynard Pittendreigh. I am the interim pastor of College Park, and we welcome you to this worship experience. Psalm 116 says, "What shall we return to the Lord for all the good things he has done for us? We will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord."
Oh,
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty and merciful God, we've erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare those who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent according to your promises declared to the world in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for his sake, that we may live a holy, just, and humble life. To the glory of your holy name we pray. Amen. We read in John chapter 3, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the good news of the gospel. Therefore, let us sing to the glory of God.
Thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
God, in Jesus Christ, you taught us to pray and to offer our petitions to you in your name. Guide us by your Holy Spirit, that our prayers for others may serve your will and show your steadfast love. Hear us as we pray for the world. You made all things in your wisdom, and in your love you save us. We pray for the whole creation. Overthrow evil powers, right what is wrong, feed and satisfy those who thirst for justice, so that all your people may freely enjoy the earth you have made and joyfully sing your praises. Hear us as we pray for the church. You have called us to be the church of Jesus Christ. Keep us one in faith and service, breaking bread together and proclaiming the good news to the world, that all may believe you are love, turn to your ways, and live in the light of your truth. Hear us as we pray for peace. You sent your Son Jesus Christ to us as a Savior to break down the walls of hostility that divide us. Send peace on earth and put down greed and pride and anger, which turn nations against nation and race against race. Speed the day when wars will end and the whole world will accept your rule. Hear us as we pray for enemies. We cannot love unless we also love our neighbors. Remove hate and prejudice from us and from all people, so that your children may be reconciled with those we fear, resent, or threaten, and live together in peace. Hear us as we pray for those who govern us. You are sovereign over the nations. Direct those who make, administer, and judge our laws, the President of the United States, and all others in authority among us, that they may be guided by your wisdom and led into the way of righteousness. Hear us as we pray for the sick. Merciful God, you bear the pain of the world. Look with compassion upon those who are sick. Cheer them by your word. Bring healing as a sign of your grace. Heavenly Father, these are our common concerns as a church, and now silently we lift up to you our private concerns quietly within our own hearts. And now together we join our voices as one as we continue to address you as our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson for today comes from Exodus chapter 20, beginning with verse 1, continuing through verse 17. Let us listen to the word of the Lord. And God spoke all of these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to the thousands of generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all of your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son nor your daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien which is in your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant, a maidservant, his ox, or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Let us also hear the New Testament lesson found in Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 25 and continuing through verse 32. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. This is a reading from the Word of the Lord. When I was in my second year of seminary training to be a minister, one of the biggest surprises of my life was to see Zeb Osborne walk up the front steps and start attending classes. I had met Zeb Osborne a couple of years earlier. Before I entered the ministry, I worked in the South Carolina Department of Corrections as a counselor working with inmates. And Zeb Osborne was one of those inmates. Zeb was once described as the meanest man in South Carolina prisons. He was an impressive person physically because, well, he had no nose. Someone had bitten it off in a fight in the prison cafeteria. But Zeb had experienced a conversion, and unlike many jailhouse conversions, Zeb's experience was real. He eventually got out of prison and went to seminary, and from there he started a prison ministry that was well respected in the state of South Carolina. And I invited Zeb to come to a church that I served several years ago as our revival preacher. And when I suggested his name to the session, there were some concerns. After all, that church was in South Carolina, and a few people knew who Zeb Osborne was. He was frequently in the newspaper. And naturally, some were concerned that his conversion had not been real, but was a hoax to get him a parole. Others worried about what might happen, what Zeb might do. Suppose somebody loses some money and they want to blame Zeb, someone asked. Another was one who was much more direct. Suppose we catch Zeb stealing the money. What do we do? One of the members of the session, unaware of Zeb's full police record, tried to reassure the other elders, but failed to select his words very carefully. I don't see why you're worried about every little thing, he said. Zeb's not going to steal anything. Zeb's not in prison for stealing, although that was some of why he was there. Zeb's not in prison for stealing. He was in prison for killing a man. Well, needless to say, that didn't comfort anyone. But I share this story because it illustrates how we in our society feel about anyone who would steal. We have a low regard for them. And once they steal, we never trust them again. Or if we do trust them, it's only because they've done what Zeb Osborne has done, making a dramatic and complete turnaround from a lifestyle of stealing and everything else. And we feel this way because most of us at one time or other have been the victim of someone who has violated the commandment, thou shalt not steal. I mean, we've returned home from vacation to find an open door, a broken window, Grandma's silver is gone, the TV's missing, the computer vanished. Or we stepped into our car to find out that someone has stolen our anti-theft device. Many of us at one time or other have felt the anger, the helpless frustration, the feeling of being violated when it comes to being the victim of someone who broke the commandment, thou shalt not steal. And if we've not had the misfortune of being the victim, we certainly know what it's like to live in fear of becoming a target of some nameless thief. We lock our doors and windows, we buy elaborate alarm systems, we buy a dog, we still wake up at 3 a.m. when all of a sudden we are filled with fear that someone's breaking in. What was that noise? I think I heard. And we listen carefully to the silence, trying to know, are those footsteps? Of course, if we listen carefully to what we've said this morning, we're always the victims of stealing. We're never the guilty ones. It's the Zeb Osbournes out there in the world who steal from us. We're not stealing from anything. It is the man whose face is covered by a mask, not a COVID mask, who enters the store with a gun, whose only identified mark is an obscene tattoo on his forearm. It's the nameless, faceless people who come in the darkness and steal from our home. It's the teenager who's been hanging around with the wrong crowd. It's the old man who doesn't know any other way of life. It's never us. We would never steal. I'm reminded of a minister who preached about the sin of gossiping. He was not really preaching to the entire congregation. He was preaching to Mrs. Smith and Mrs. Jones. And Mrs. Smith could always be seen leaning over the backyard fence talking to Mrs. Jones. And the two would talk on and on about all the shortcomings of all the members of the community. Not a single indiscretion could be committed without Mrs. Jones or Mrs. Smith picking up on it, embellishing a few additional details, and then passing it on to everyone else in the community until everybody knew the whole embellished story. The minister preached his sermon and came down very hard on the sin of gossip. And after the service, both Mrs. Jones and Mrs. Smith came up to the minister and said how happy they were that he had preached that particular sermon, because they knew how badly the neighbors, the Johnsons, were gossiping and how badly they needed to hear that sermon. Moses comes down from the mountain. He's got in his arms the tablets. He begins to read what's written on them. And he gets to the law, thou shalt not steal. And our first reaction is to think, well, surely he does not mean us. Like Mrs. Jones and Mrs. Smith, who are notorious gossips, but who believe that they are the pictures of innocence. We are convinced that we never have been, nor ever could be, guilty of stealing. But the commandment is not addressed over our heads to those outside the community of the church. It's aimed at us. God tells us that we are not to steal. And I suspect he goes to the trouble of doing that because, believe it or not, we do steal. And maybe we don't do it like Zeb Osbourne once did by pointing a gun at someone's face and demanding your money or your life. But if we are honest, we find ways in which we have all come short of obedience to this commandment. This morning, I want us to think about three specific warning signs that may indicate that we are guilty of stealing. The first warning sign is when we say to ourselves, we're not stealing because it's not a person, it's an institution. And we're surrounded by institutions that somehow involve transactions of money. The IRS, the Internal Revenue Service. It's a very impersonal institution. In fact, it may be hard to think of it as anything other than impersonal. The IRS is always coming after our money. Every paycheck, they take a little bit off the top. And if you're self-employed, every quarter, you have to write out your own tax payments and send it in. It's easy to begin to justify cheating with the IRS because it's such a large institution with no personality. We're not taking money from them. We're not stealing money from them. We're just not reporting everything. We're blatantly cheating on our deductions. We are stealing. But because it's such a large impersonal institution, we justify our actions. And the same can be said about insurance companies. We have a wreck. We find a way to claim a much bigger settlement than we're entitled to. After all, it's not a person we're stealing from. It's just an institution. Or we give our employer expense vouchers for business meals that don't really exist. It's just an institution. We're not really stealing from a person. Somehow or other, we become comfortable in justifying our actions. And we fool ourselves into thinking we're not really stealing because we don't have a gun in hand and we're not saving your money or your life. But somehow we're taking something that doesn't belong to us. Now, another warning sign is when we hear ourselves say we're not stealing, we're just taking what belongs to us. Most people who embezzle money from the company where they work do not think of it as stealing, at least not at first. Everyone else does, the boss, the family, the police, the judge, but they do not, because in their mind they're simply taking what they intend to give back, or they're taking just a little bit of money that they feel they should have gotten in a raise, but for some reason they didn't get that raise. So it's in their mind, it's the same as theirs. You can't steal what belongs to you, and therefore it is not stealing. That way of thinking could extend to the most innocent levels, such as stealing your next door neighbor's rake because he never returned the shovel he borrowed 2 years ago, so therefore you're taking payment for the shovel. Or it may literally escalate to a more complex embezzlement of thousands of dollars because you see something and you convince yourself in some way, well, it's mine anyway. Third warning sign is that we're stealing. When we hear ourselves saying, we're not just stealing, we're just not giving. In the Bible, one of the ways we steal is to steal from God. And the way we steal from God is to refuse to be charitable and give to others out of our abundance. There's a verse from the Old Testament book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 8, which says, will a man rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? And God's reply is, in tithes and offerings. When we fail to give charitably, we steal. When we eat out on steak and prime rib and lobster, but refuse to contribute the least little amount to the food drive, to share with the children in our community, we are, in a sense, stealing from God. We refuse to contribute money to community charities because we want our money for our new boat and our new golf clubs or whatever, more than we want to help people. And when we have an abundance and we do not give out of that abundance to share with others who are in desperate need, we are stealing from God. These are acts of a thief because what we possess, ultimately, we do not own. The money, the property that we have been given to us by God to use and to administer. And there's a sense in which everything we own is simply on loan to us from God. And to use our possessions in a consistently selfish manner that takes no account of others is, according to Malachi in the Old Testament, stealing from God. Thou shalt not steal, says the commandment. That's something that a lot of people need to hear. We tend to think of to ourselves as, well, thank goodness I don't need to hear this one. I'm okay with this commandment. I don't know, maybe not. When it comes to the Ten Commandments, every one of them is an opportunity for self-reflection. And to ponder, how is it that we might be breaking this commandment? And now to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be ascribed all might, power, dominion, and glory, today and forever. Amen.
So sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me 'neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Yes, dear sweet, trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Trust Him
and how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, and how I've proved Him more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more, Him more,
trust Him more,
trust Him.
Go forth and serve the Lord with love, energy, imagination, and creativity. Go forth filled with a joyous heart. And may God's many blessings enrich our lives and enable us to live with thanksgiving today and always. Amen.
Thank you.